Good morning. Today is Sunday, June 18th, 2017. This is the second Sunday after Pentecost. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our worship services day. Happy Father's Day to all the fathers here this morning as our nation observes its annual Father's Day celebration. This being a communion Sunday, all of the service is in your bulletin except for the hymns, and also I would ask that you use it for the confession and forgiveness instead of what's printed in your bulletin, because some of your little changes from what's printed there. So, if you please turn to page 94, and invite those who can't have difficulty to please stay. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors and ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together in Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. We begin our worship with Morning Has Broken, hymn number 556, in the back of your red worship. Hymn number 556.
Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. This is the 18th of June, 2017. We're happy to have you watching us on YouTube. All of us on the YouTube land. This is our open hymn, Morning Has Broken, written by Eleanor Ferrigion. Lived 1881-1965. It's a Gaelic tune. Listen to the Gaelic rhythm. Happy Father's Day.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Singing gospel acclamation. This is the second Sunday after Pentecost. Our pastor is Pastor John Pollock. He'll be reading the scripture. Jesus is there beside him. They're reading the gospel together. Think in your mind. Feel Jesus' presence. We're singing the Alleluia. The pastor is there. We honor the gospel of Jesus.
He had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits, to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Cananean, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: Go nowhere among the Gentiles, and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You receive without payment, give without payment. Take no gold or silver or copper in your belts, no bag for your journey, or two tunics or sandals or a staff, for laborers deserve their food. Whatever town or village you enter, find out who in it is worthy and stay there until you leave. As you enter the house, greet it. If the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet as you leave that house or town. Truly I tell you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah on that day of judgment than for that town. See, I am sending you out like sheep into the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of them, for they will hand you over to councils and fly you in their synagogues, and you will be dragged before governors and kings because of me, as testimony to them and the Gentiles. When they hand you over, do not worry about how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given you at that time. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will betray brother to death, and a father his child, and children will rise against parents and have them put to death, and you will be hated by all because of my name. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next. For truly I tell you, you will not have gone through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
And you may be seated. A couple of announcements to share with you. First of all, as you may have already seen in the paper, our sister Norma Huff was called from the church militant to the church triumphant this past week. There will be visitation from 5 to 6 here in the church tomorrow night, and then a memorial service will begin at 6, or approximately at 6, here in the sanctuary as well. So
Again, tomorrow, here at the church from 5 to 6, visitation for Norma Huff, and 6 o'clock memorial service. Also, there has been, you may have noticed in the parking lot, another container next to the one for your paper. This one is for cardboard. So as you collect your paper around the house, to put into the one container we have already. The one next to it is for cardboard, so you can bring your cardboard boxes and whatever cardboard you have and place it into that. In the front pew are sign-up sheets for July and August for readers, communion assistants, and the like. We need you to sign up. Also, there is a sheet for signing up for the fair, to work the booth at the fair this year. All the other announcements are self-explanatory as they appear in the bulletin. So now I ask that you give your attention to our ladies who will present to you a special song for this night.
Vicki Perks and Becky Dimitroff will sing a song.
Thank you.
It's now time to get your sermon notes. Also, if you have a Bible, or if you did not bring your own Bible, I would encourage you to take the Bible out of the pew, because our sermon text for today is not any of the lessons that we read for today. Instead, we are talking about a noble father from the fourth chapter of the Gospel of John. So you may wish to go ahead and turn to that fourth chapter before it comes time for me to read. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, for those of you my age, and all of you will recall this, for those of you who are younger, you haven't experienced this, because ever since the 70s, husbands have been allowed to be in the delivery room with their wives, and I guess now that even whole families can be in there if they want to. But back, still to the time Jean and I had our first child, husbands weren't allowed in the delivery room. You went to a waiting room. So it was one day in a father's waiting room at a hospital in Minnesota, and there were three fathers there waiting to hear from a nurse, of course, what their wives had delivered. So the nurse came in and approached the first man, and she said to him, "You're the father of twins." To which the father said, "How about that? I work for the Double Cola Company." And so the nurse went back out. Sometime later, she came back to him and approached the second father, and she said, "Sir, you're the father of triplets." To which the father said, "I work for the 3M Company. I guess triplets fit in perfectly." So as the nurse was turning to leave, she noticed the third man, who was already as nervous as could be, grabbing his coat and hat. And she said, "Where are you going?" And he turned to her and says, "I'm getting out of here." He says, "I work for the 7-Up Company." Today is Father's Day. And a difference from Mother's Day. In the fact that on Mother's Day, all we hear are wonderful words about our mothers, words of admiration, words of love, words of respect, words of compassion. But when Dad's Day rolls around, it seems like there is always someone, and I just fulfilled that tradition, that has to make Dad the butt of a joke. For some reason, Dad's Day just doesn't have that same respect to it as Mother's Day for some reason. But today, we are going to learn about a father of whom no one could make jokes. A father who, as I entitled on your sermon notes, a noble father. In order to learn about this noble father, we turn to that fourth chapter of the Gospel of St. John. And we go down to the end of that chapter, to the 46th verse. And as St. John records, we read, "So he, Jesus, came again to Cana in Galilee, where he had made the water wine. And at Capernaum, there was an official whose son was ill. When this man heard that Jesus had come from Judea to Galilee, he went to him and asked him to come down and heal his son, for he was at the point of death. So Jesus said to him, 'Unless you see signs and wonders, you will not believe.' The official said to him, 'Sir, come down before my child dies.' Jesus said to him, 'Go, your son will live.' The man believed the word that Jesus spoke to him and went on his way. As he was going down, his servant met him and told him that his son was recovering. So he asked them the hour when he was beginning to get better, and they said to him, 'Yesterday at the 7th hour, the fever left him.' The father knew that was the hour when Jesus said to him, 'Your son will live.' And he himself believed, and all his household." In our text, Jesus encounters a noble. Some scholars translate the word translated as nobleman as little king, believing he was some type of king under Herod.
in position. He's a man of wealth. And he comes searching for Jesus. Now, the difference between, or the distance between Cana and Capernaum was 20 miles. So this was no short trip for this man. And yet, he does not hesitate to seek Jesus out. And what we see by his actions are that people of all ranks and stations need the Lord in Jesus Christ, which is different from some of the world's religions, where if you're not of a certain rank or station, they are not concerned about you at all, no matter how much you worship. And so here we see that love of Jesus, that he takes us where we are. He doesn't make us reach a certain rank. He doesn't make us reach a certain station. He doesn't make us reach a certain economic level or educational level. He takes us right where we are. He takes us as good as we are or as bad as we are. He takes us as successful as we may be, or he takes us as being the biggest failure that there may be. He takes us whether we're rich or poor, whether we're well-educated or not. He does not care what our ethnic origin is or what our race is or what country we live in. He is only interested in us as a person. So Jesus meets people where they are and ministers to them, not caring about any of those outside restrictions or requirements. He ministers to us where we are at the time we are, at the place we are, not telling us that we have to change or move to some other place. In this incident, a loving father sought help for his son. The wise father knows where to go when his children are in need. And fathers who bring their children to Jesus Christ show their love for them. Jesus had been in Galilee on a mission trip and has returned to Cana. The Lord's first miracle having been performed there when he turned the water into wine, as we read in the second chapter of St. John's Gospel. In his return, it catches the attention of this nobleman. His son's sickness leads him searching for Jesus. What good news it must have been for him that Jesus had returned. Leaving Capernaum, he heads for Cana to find Jesus. Again, notice this man's humility. He's a nobleman, possibly some kind of sub-team to Herod. And he doesn't sit back and say, well, Jesus is just some country bumpkin rabbi. He needs to come to me. No, he goes to Jesus. He's heard about Jesus. He's heard what wonderful things Jesus can do. He's heard that Jesus could possibly be that long-expected Messiah. And so he does not hesitate to leave his residence and come searching for Gina. For Jesus. I've done that several times in my life. Sorry, Jesus. He goes searching for Jesus. For those of you who are new to us and may not be Gina's my wife. He wasn't looking for Gina. He was looking for Jesus. He didn't care where he had to go. His only concern was about his son who was ill. So what do you do when your children are in need? The answer is what you should do is to pray to Jesus and tell him the need of your children, and Jesus will listen and answer your prayer. When I graduated from seminary, my first call was to a small church in Evansville, Indiana. And it was in Evansville where our youngest son, Matthew, was born. And when Matthew was about 6 months old or so, one of Gina's friends, who she worked with, came by on a Saturday and picked her up to go on a shopping trip. And so they had finished shopping and they were returning home, and a drunk driver rammed into the back of the car. This was in the days before the mandatory seats for children, and I believe her friend's car didn't even have seatbelts in the back seat. They had them in the front. Gina hit the dashboard. bounced off the seat, but he was all right. But Joel went forward and hit the back of the top of the seat, and it punctured his intestine. So, of course, they all were taken to the hospital, and they all were checked out, except for Joel. He had to have emergency surgery. So I had called my parents, and they came over from Louisville, and I called a fellow Lutheran pastor down, who was my best friend. And when he got there, he had us all gathered in a circle, and we all joined hands. And he led us in a prayer, praying for Joel, praying for the surgeon and the nurses, praying for recovery, that Joel would recover, and that all would be successful. And everything was, and Joel never suffered any side effects from that injury. But that was an example where we were in need, and our need led us to prayer to Jesus to help us in that situation. The nobleman likewise knew that his own power wasn't enough. It didn't matter who he was. It didn't matter how much power he had politically. It didn't matter how much financial power he had. He knew it just wasn't enough. And you contrast that with many people today who think that they don't need Jesus Christ. They don't need God. If anything comes up, all they need is modern-day medicine or modern-day technology, and it will solve the problem for them. And we do give thanks to God for the wonderful advancements we've made in the medical field. We're thankful that through science and medicine, we now have seen diseases that were a problem when we were children have been totally eradicated. We see constant improvement on the treatment of those with debilitating illnesses and those with terminal illnesses, seeing lives extended longer and quality of life improved, and even the efforts of stemming, especially in terminal illnesses. And so we're thankful for that, but still, we need Jesus. With all that science, with all that technology, with all that advancement, we still need Jesus. And the nobleman recognized that even his earthly titles and power were inadequate. He needed more. Here was a titled wealthy father who had a dying son, and his political and financial clout couldn't save his son. Sometimes, and we need to recognize this more and more in this 21st century, sometimes political or financial clout is not the answer. Sometimes the answers to our problem in society are not policies of one party or another, not having more financial wealth. But the true answer is that faith in Jesus Christ. And that's what this noble father recognized with the illness of his son. The noble father invited Jesus to his house. This invitation seemed to be his only hope. We can imagine his pleading in an effort to save his son. He assumed, as we would have, that Jesus needed to come and see his son and put his hand on his son's head in order to save him. But he didn't realize some things about Jesus. Some things that sometimes we forget or we have not learned. And that is that with Jesus, distance is not an issue. We do not have to be right in the presence of Jesus for Jesus' power to work. What is important is that the Lord's word is sufficient. The lesson we learned and the lesson that noble father learned that day was that Jesus' word is sufficient. And it is that word that we must cling to, and it is that word that we must continue to treasure. It is that word that we must continue to guide our lives and guide our actions. For his word is sufficient. The noble father believed when Jesus said to him, he said in verse 50, "Go, your son will live." That word "go" means depart now. Don't wait on anything else. Don't wait for me to do anything. Go ahead and build. And the word translated "will live" means to have life. So he's saying, depart, your son will have life. Your son is in no one danger. And these words of Christ were enough for the noble father. You notice he didn't argue with Jesus. He didn't say, "Oh, but Jesus, it'd be better if you come to my house and that you can lay your hands on him and everybody can see what you do." No, he believed, said John tells us. And that word "believe" means to give credit to someone, to entrust your life to them, to have confidence in someone, to have faith in them. It means to place your life in their hands. Each step that noble father took toward Capernaum was a step of faith. The noble father's faith was blessed. His son had been healed the moment Jesus announced it. The servant and family members confirmed the miracle. As again, in verses 51 to 53, as he was going down, his servants met him and told him that his son was recovering. So he asked them the hour when he began to get better, and they said to him, "Yesterday at the seventh hour, the fever left him." The father knew that was the hour when Jesus said to him, "Your son will live." And he himself believed, and all his household. Like the noble father, we need to believe in what Jesus says. Like that noble father, we need to entrust our lives to what Jesus said. We, like the noble father, need to have confidence in what Jesus said. We, like the noble father, need to place our lives in Jesus' hands because of believing his word. There's an old legend about a crane and a swan. Some of you may be familiar with it. But it goes like this. One day there was an old crane out on a beach looking for snails. A big, beautiful white swan suddenly swooped down out of the water. The crane asked, "Where did you come from?" "From heaven," answered the swan. "Never heard of it," the crane said. "Is it far away?" "Oh, yes," said the swan. "Is it a good country?" asked the crane. The swan replied, "Yes, it is far better." And then he went on to describe all the beauties of heaven and all the benefits. The old crane then asked, "Have they any snails over there?" "Oh, no," said the swan. "They wouldn't have them in heaven." "Well, then," said the old crane, "you can have your heaven. I don't want it. I just want my snails." The attitude of the crane, unfortunately, is the attitude of too many people today. They have an opportunity for heaven and all that heaven gives us, but they would prefer the vile things of earth. The things that moth and rust destroy, and thieves break in and steal. They would sacrifice their salvation for snails, for those earthly treasures. Thankfully, the noble father knew what were the true priorities of life, and that his power and his position could not help his son, that only Jesus Christ could. The noble father's son was healed. The trip to find Jesus was worth the effort. His whole family believed, ensuring eternal life. Coming to Jesus is the noblest thing a father can do. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Those who can, please rise. With the whole church, let us confess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth.
the seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified upon Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, and is spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Our response today is, Lord, have mercy. For the Church, that she would faithfully continue the work of the 12 apostles, and that God would bless her every effort to enlarge his flock. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those called to be fathers, that God would strengthen and preserve their faith, so that they may be well equipped to lead and teach their households. Grant rest and peace of mind of all who are overwhelmed by the responsibility of their vocation. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those fathers who have abdicated their responsibilities, that God would lead them to repentance and continue to provide for their families where they are lacking. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who desire to be fathers, that God would give them peace. Wait with them, cover them with assurance of his perfect will. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the laborers of harvest, that God would continue to call faithful pastors to ministry, and let teachers, deaconess, and other church workers heed his calling, that they may be blessed in their training and sustain their vocation. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who are sick and suffering, that God would look with compassion upon his servants who are facing mental or physical illness, surgery pain, loneliness, or grief, that they may be reminded that they are not facing their things alone and be comforted with the hope of eternal life. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who receive the good gifts of the Lord's Supper, that with repentant hearts they would receive the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. For thanks to strengthening of their faith and the benefit are in their names. Lord, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Into your hands, O Lord, we command all to whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
You may be seated.
It's time for our offering. Helen Wallace and Connie Singleton are the ushers today. We have the acolyte. This is Holy Communion Sunday. You can see the candles are lit at the altar. It's a beautiful altar with the flowers today. Flowers are presented today to the glory of God. And presented by Linda Fox. in honor of Father's Day. This is the second of, this is the 18th of June 2017, Father's Day. The flowers on the chancel stands, which are the glory of God. Linda Fox, in honor of family and friends, James, Jean, and Art, Denny, and Mike, and Debbie Cochran, in memory of Glenn Cochran, for his birthday and Father's Day. This is Father's Day. Happy Father's Day. We're thankful to all fathers. Said prayers and blessings today for fathers. This is St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. We're happy to have you with us today, second Sunday of Pentecost. We're happy to have you sign up to be worship assistants. And while we have a sign-up sheet, we're going to be at the fair. If you want to come to our church and want service and sign up, or call the church office if you want to sign up to help that. Today we had Gina Pollock reading the scripture. Helen Wallace and Connie Singleton are our ushers now today. We welcome you to come to St. John's Lutheran. We say we're happy for all you people out in the land of YouTube. You're watching us on YouTube, and we pray that you will show people how to use YouTube so you can spread the gospel. Jesus tells us that we should spread the gospel throughout the world. He also heals a nobleman's son. The noblest thing a man can do is look to Jesus and his power and word and believe in Jesus to help him, as the noble father did in the scripture today. We thank you for that, O Lord.
Please stand.
Let us pray. Holy God, gracious and merciful, you bring forth food from the earth and nourish your whole creation. Turn our hearts to those who hunger in any way, that all may know your care. And prepare us now to the feast on the bread of life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. St. John practices an open communion for all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as a personal Lord and Savior. We believe his body and blood are truly present as we gather at his table, and are of communion age in their own individual congregation. You're invited and encouraged to come forward with us this day as we gather at the table of the Lord. We continue our celebration of the Great Thanksgiving on page 6 in your bulletin. The Lord be with you. Saying, take and eat, this is my body given for you.
Do this
for the cup, gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, this cup is new covenant in my blood shed for you, for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Remembering therefore his salutary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to, O Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we are. We ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgivings, and with your word and Holy Spirit, bless us, your servants, and these your own gifts of bread and wine, so that we and all who share in the body and blood of Christ may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people, and be given our inheritance with all your saints. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church, now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you.
thank you for the mystery of the reception of Jesus' true body and blood. As the transformation takes place for the elements, we receive his real body. As he has said, we take his body and blood and we receive eternal life. He commands us to do this in memory of him. This is what we've done today. We thank you so much. Jesus is within us. We're within him. We're all one. We've received his body and blood. We believe this in the depths of our soul. In favor of missionary work. This song, I Love to Tell the Story, was written to encourage missionaries as they entered foreign land. She also worked with Wilberforce to eliminate slavery. This was in 1834 to 1911. Catherine Hankey, English woman songwriter.
Thank you.
people out in YouTube land for watching us, for participating in this worship service. We worship God, our Father, Son, Holy Spirit. We receive the true presence of the Son, Jesus Christ, as he has promised, and he keeps his promise. He is here with us. When two or three are gathered together in his name, he is with us. St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio, we thank you for worshiping with us today. We want you to come to the drive-in service. It's 8 o'clock at Melody Cruise Inn, rain or shine. We had service today, wonderful service, and at 10:30 service in the sanctuary. Come and help us as we try to minister to the poor. We do as God has commanded us. For as you have done it to the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you have done it unto me. We encounter Christ through every good deed we do, and we are with Christ. He is with us. We're together. We know him. We have our experience with him. We experience him through reading the Bible. We experience him through worship. We invite you to come worship with us. We invite you to participate in a lot of the activities that we're doing here at the corner of Wittenberg, Columbia, Springfield, Ohio, St. John's Lutheran Church. We want you to help us. We want you to participate with us. As Jesus has commanded us to go into all the world and preach the gospel to everyone. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Happy Father's Day also. And be like the noble man who prayed to Jesus for the healing of his son, who believed in Jesus, that Jesus would heal him, who accepted the word of Jesus, the love of Jesus. Jesus loved us. We love him. Jesus loves us. And we love him back. He loves us first. And when we love him, we do as he commands, which is to do unto others as we have them do unto us. We love God and we love our neighbors. Just as Jesus has said, we do that. We obey what he says. We have eternal life. We receive him through his body and blood. He's with us every single minute of every single day. We thank you so much for worshiping with us and helping us to spread the gospel through YouTube and our service. Come in person or watch and receive the Holy Spirit. Receive Jesus' true presence with us in virtual taking of Holy Communion. Thank you for our ushers, Carol Glaze, Connie Singleton, all those who participated today. Our announcer, Dr. Sally Abbott, and the videographer is Linda Fox.